on air. Okay, praise the Lord. So we are sorry about that. It has we don't know what happened. The devil wanted to embarrass the children of God. But the Lord is good all the time, and all things work for good for those that love the Lord. So, like I said, my message is narrower is the way. Praise the Lord. Welcome to the CHMI Sunday Fellowship. My name is Pastor Jeff. The title of my message is Narrower is the Way, taken from Matthew chapter 7, verse 13. Today, I'm going to expound on the revelation which I got from the Lord Jesus Christ on the 22nd of October, 2022. This was a revelation on the journey of a believer from the time a person believes or accepts the Lord Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, and then through the journey until you are raptured or until you die and enter into His presence. That was. I'll explain it once more. I'll share the revelation once again during the course of the meeting. Praise the Lord. But the Bible teaches us in Matthew chapter 7, verse 13 and 14, that enter ye in at the strait gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. Many there be which go in therein. Many people are going through the broad road because it's easy. It's easy. The cross or the way that the Lord Jesus Christ advised us to follow was the way that this is the cross. This is the cross which is heavy. The cross is heavy, brethren. The cross is heavy. You can only be helped by the Lord Himself. But today we've got the plastic cross, which has made things easier, and people still think they are in the church whilst they are on their way to destruction. That's why you see that in the church today, everything goes. Everything is accepted in the church. Sin is not rebuked in the church today. Because the ministers of God or the servants of God see the souls in the church as their customers. They extract some money at the end of every week and once a month is tithes and offerings, which I service. So we as Christians, we have done a great deal of damage to the body of Christ and those terrorists that are fighting us or the satanic kingdom. We have shot ourselves in the foot when we want to move. So the straight gate is not a shut gate. How do we get to this gate? We get it through the faithfulness of a holy God. The faithfulness of a holy God. Yes, the way is difficult. It is against our nature. You have got to die to yourself. You cannot enter onto that path, into that gate with flesh. As Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 51, flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Certain things must die in your life. That's why the Lord said in Luke chapter 9, verse 23, pick up your cross and follow me daily. It must be a daily exercise. So narrow is the way, but now it's narrower than it was before. Because grace is abound, the two spirits have arrived at the same time now. That's why there is greater deception today. We think we still can live the way that we want to live, because God is a forgiving God. The same God, I will tell you, that is a very terrible God. Very terrible. He is gracious, yes. But to fall in His hands is something that man should fear. God, I do not want to be in your hands. So this is the tenderness of a merciful Father as we go onto that path. Narrow path. He will be holding us. It's not like we are alone. During that journey, yes, I was alone as I was going up. It was a very arduous journey. Going up the hills. There's no climbing down, only going up. And if you turn back or if you want to Look at it like this: there is a greater chance that you will fall. The higher you go, the more chances are that you will fall. So I'm quite surprised when I see servants of God boasting that I know God. The closer you get to Him, the more you know that you don't deserve to be in His presence. When you see people say, "Ah, I know Jesus," I know you don't know Him. You fear to utter that name. The closer you get to Him, that's why Apostle Peter said, "Go away from me. Go away. I'm a sinful man. What do you want from me?" The closer you get to Him, the more you know you don't deserve to be in His presence. That's why Apostle Paul said, "I am a chief sinner." All those people that you see, once you see this element of boasting, don't worry, the devil is at work. They have gotten their reward yet. People should not boast and say, "I know Christ, I know God." Yes, we know Him to a certain measure to follow Him. You can never know God. The angels in eternity, the angels in heaven now, they do not know God at all. Yet they have lived thousands of years with Him. They don't know God. Talk less of you, human beings. All those names that we hear describing God, the names of God, Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Nissi, these are just the descriptive words of God. You cannot describe Him in human words. You cannot. These are just the describing words. If you've got a situation and come here, you are my helper. Oh, you are my savior. You saved me today. Not that I can save. No, you are trying to describe what I have done for you. Those are descriptive names of God, not like the names of God. God, my helper. God, my this. Yes, it's okay to acknowledge Him. Those are just descriptions. You cannot put God. That's why you see those names are many. God means anything to anybody, depending on what He has done to you in your life. You say, God, God, my Father. Why? He has done something that a father, only a father could do to you. Only Him could make this ultimate sacrifice. So we are talking about narrow way. Way is even narrower today than it was before. So, like I said, this road or this path is against our nature. Once we wake up, say, "Oh, on the narrow path again," find this resistance. We are fighting against this nature every day because it wants to go on the broad road. Things are easy on the broad road. Things are easy. So we trust on the faithfulness of a holy God. Even though the way is difficult, but He said, "I will be with you even until the end of the age." That's a firm promise. Remember, the Bible says, "He will neither forsake us nor leave us. The one that watches over Israel neither sleeps nor slumber." So there is a gate. So this gate leadeth unto life. But on that gate now, all the pleasures of the world must remain at that gate. It's like you are going through a place where anything unholy must stop there. I don't know the English word, just sin, like theft, something like theft, that anything that of a particular size cannot go in, of a particular kind, you can never go in. So all the pleasures of the sin must be left behind. That means only holiness. You must look forward to holiness. Say, "God, I'm prepared for that which you have prepared for me before the creation of the world." So those who neither enter, those who want to, sorry, those who enter neither makes nor open the gate. You don't open it, you don't make it. Let us be very clear. You only find it. We only find the gate. No man makes the gate, no man, but now the gate, which is the broad gate, is the one the devil makes. Say, "Look, my son, you can go this way." So men cannot make ways of peace for themselves. We can never bring peace amongst ourselves. Neither can we force it. Like I read Isaiah chapter 4, verse 6. "It's not by might, it's not by power, but by my spirit, saith the Lord." It's only God that gives the grace for us to move on. Us to be able to. We cannot force. But when you make the way, you keep it open. So that when you go in, you are always going in with the joy of the Lord. Why? Because salvation, that the salvation at the gate, there is joy because that gate is open. There's salvation because that gate cannot be forced. It is open, cannot be closed. So it is one thing to for people to boast of salvation. That's why the Bible says you are saved by grace, not of our own. So here, brethren, we need to wound our own flesh. We need to wound our flesh for us to be assured to enter. It's a narrow path. If you are big, you'll have to force your way, but as you go in, scratches will come in. But there is something that is awaiting you there. You cannot go on a broad road. There are sacrifices to be made. These are things that are done without intervention from a human being. No mediator, no pastor. No pastor. Only God Himself. This is the sacrifice which the Lord Jesus Christ made for us. There is no gate on that side. With one way that you enter. Once you enter, you are on the straight path. So, what does the Bible say? Straight gate and the wide gate. The straight gate, they produce destruction. They both produce. This one is taking peace away from you. This one is taking the peace which you thought you had and giving you the peace which the Lord gives. So some of these paths that leads to, they lead to the destruction of character. That's where destruction comes in. The Bible says, good company, bad companies corrupt good company. So you must be aware of the kind of people that you deal with, friends that you meet that you don't know where they're coming from. They just suddenly want to be friends with you. So, destruction of character. And some of this path, some of this Broadway, they can lead to the destruction of your health. If you are living anyhow, you can go in there and get some diseases because it's a broad road. Many people died young. Please forgive me, I want to take some water. My throat is still dry. So, destruction of health. Many people are sick today. Some were smoking, they got lung cancer. Some were smoking, they got STIs, STDs. All these things, they all lead to the destruction of our soul. So, when the Bible teaches us to obey the laws of God, He says we are obeying it for our own good, for our own good. So let us remember that. The big road is wide enough to accept ignorance. Ignorance. Why? Anything you're ignorant, just go. Anything goes. Once saved, forever gone, forever saved. That's what says God. Now, cohabitation has been accepted in the church. Cohabitation, where a man and a wife, husband, they live as husband and wife, not according to the glory of God, but they've modernized. This is the new modernized cross. This is the broad road. This is the broad road, brethren. There you can be sure that you will perish. You can see from the numbers which bear the ungodly company, because there are so many. It looks fun. You look sad. Just imagine when Noah was building the ark. He built the ark. Of course, it was completed. 100, I think 112, 113 years when his grandfather Methuselah died. I think he mourned for 7 years before the flood came. People were laughing at him. They said, look at this one, look at this one. These are things that were not done in a day. But this time of Noah, that's why the Lord said, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall be in the time, on the day on which the Son of Man comes. What was he trying to say? This was the time of the Father's grace. People have been given time to repent. Imagine 120 years. If my grandfather was here, I probably could have met him now. He probably could have died a few years ago. 120 years. They said Noah is a foolish person. Why are you building the ark? Don't you see? He built this year. Some people are going to the field. Noah said, "My children, come. Let us do. Let us do it together." So this, we are living in the time of the Father's grace. Our time is practically finished. There is no time, brethren. The devil got this revelation, Revelation chapter 12, verse 11 and 12, when he said, "My time is short. Too short." If the devil got this revelation 2,000 years ago, what about? How long do you think you're going to live in this earthly body? Brethren, we need to take our time. Once you go to sleep and never wake up, judgment is passed. So we have got an obligation on the narrow path. It's a highway of holiness. It's a path of righteousness, which is the benchmark of entry into the kingdom. We see here the two ways being contrasted, broad and narrow. So the idea which our Lord gives here is the future misery of on the broad way. You are going to say yes, but there is a future that is waiting for you, a future that is inescapable. Brethren, on the narrow path, the powers of the soul are preserved. It is only those sensational gratification of lust of the flesh can be destroyed as you get onto the narrow path. Those are the pleasures of the sins that you live and that get as you pursue. For these people that get onto the narrow path, life, the world becomes dim, dark to whatever it is happening. It doesn't concern you. Whatever is happening anywhere in the world, it's not your business. You mind your business. This is where we are today. So the Lord is warning us about the future misery, destruction going to come. For us that are sanctifying our flesh, that are living the pleasures of the lust of the flesh at the gate, it's a positive punishment God gives us by His justice, so that we can be able to enter. But for those on the broad road, the destruction is complete, sudden, certain, and eternal. Very eternal. Like we said, the judgments of God is sure. Remember Romans chapter 2, verse 16. God is going to judge the secrets of men by the gospel of Apostle Paul. He is going to judge all the things that we do in secret are the things that are going to most likely condemn us. So there was a confirmation of the sentence concerning the gate that is wide. Way of sin is broad, considering the ease which it is found. It is easy to commit sin. That's why it is narrow. Let us go and steal. Let us go and kill people. Let us go and do this. But we cannot ask brethren to come and pray for, which is a shame. That's why the Bible says it's narrow. Broad is the way, because the easiness, the simpleness of which we find ourselves committing sin, why it brings with it comes with a lot of enticements and snaring, where it throws a hook on a fish. When you see the hook, oh, it appeals to you. Remember, if you were saved stealing, when you backslide stealing. Usually you don't go and start committing a new sin altogether. It's always the one that appeals to your heart. So broad is to accept the persons of all anything that goes. Ah, this one is my friend. Ah, this one is my friend. Everybody is your person. You have no net that leaves the things and desired things are out. rest. So entering in the straight gate implies that you need this self-discipline. This one, the straight gate, it reminds us of the imminent danger. It's coming and coming faster. That's why I say, God, help me to remain on your side. Help me to remain anchored on your side. Help me to remain abiding on your side. Because the broad way, there are a lot of things, brethren, that are not going to help us. So the sinner is this as a sinner, my immediate duty, because we are all sinners. Don't consider yourself now, I am righteous, I'm holy. Continue to not that you sin, no. Continue to ask God for more mercy. Say, Lord, I'm not yet perfect. Help me to stand right before you. Because why? This is the duty, immediate duty of a sinner, to search the scriptures, self-examination, prayer, belief in the Lord Jesus Christ. Otherwise, destruction of sinners will be charged themselves. Thank God, if you are on the narrow way, you will help yourself because you say, God, this is what I have chosen. People can look at you today as somebody, but there's always a price to be. So the way to life and the way to destruction, the Bible. As we are seeing in the world today, you see how much fashion is coming today, how much human rights are coming in today, transgender, LGBTQ, I don't know how many alphabets are coming. You can just imagine, broad is the way. This one says, I don't smoke, you smoke, you say you're a Christian. You don't do this, you say you're a Christian. So they always point to the things that we do as Christians. That's why the Bible says, Romans chapter 2, verse 24, God's name is blasphemed among the Gentiles. They will live. So they come back to us and accuse us because they were against us. They have something against us. So the Bible teaches us and warns us how to direct ourselves to the other world, which this life is. But it's like a road that leads to life, like an avenue. It's a safe course. The other one is unsafe, of course. Our duty and interest with respect to these gates must always be manned at any time because you can fall. The Bible said, behold, if you think you're standing, lest you fall. These two gates, they are very dangerous. It's extremely dangerous. So the broad road is wide. It's broad. It's not hampered by conscience. Your conscience doesn't work anymore. Your conscience doesn't work anymore. It's not hampered by the Bible. You don't need even to see the Bible. You never make use of it. You make use of your carnal senses. And that's it. Because your sense. But what does the safe way tell us? Straight is the gate. The gate is straight. The way is narrow. It is like straight shoe that presses the foot. It is not easy walking in it. There was a time when I got a shoe, I think it was 19-something, early 90s. I bought a shoe, it was called Docksiders. Docksiders, very, very good shoe. So, because I had many, many years of not putting the shoe, so the shoe was like, you know, the foot was like this. So through many years of putting shoes, now it's looking good. But then it was like this, so it's compressed like this. So right at the top where the foot is, it's like it was not easy. You will only walk a short distance, get into a car, drive off, or you in an ordinary bus, drive off. So there was so much pain, believe me. I had blisters from that shoe. So as I was just thinking, say, oh, this is how it is, say yes. When you put on that shoe, it's a good shoe, but the It reminds you of what you are carrying. It reminds you of where you are going. The happy tendency, I'm happy. I know I'm putting on a show. I was not putting on a show. Now I'm putting on a show. I'm happy. So the pain of not putting, the pain of the shoe is not greater than the pain of walking on a barefoot. So you could, as a person who didn't have much then, I could identify with it. So what makes the gait straight now? Because it is contrary to our nature. There are a lot of lusts of the flesh that are hanging about the soul. Everything about the flesh comes. There's opposition made by the devil to the soul's entry. You don't get it easy. The devil said, no, you are not going to enter. This is the road. He said, no, my God said, the narrow way. So your flesh will be fighting you. Remember I said, your old self, the flesh, sin, the world, and the devil, they'll be fighting you. These are the four, generally four or five forces that fight you each day when you wake up. The flesh, the old man comes and says, no, I do not want to do this. This is not life. Look at John. They said yesterday they went out, they were so happy. Look at some Christians, they live miserable life. What's happening? You say this man is not a Christian. All his daughters are married. All his children are in university. He earns less than I am. I am a Christian. What is happening? You can see the difference, but what is happening? So being not a Christian, you will see like grass is green, but when you get there, you see it's brown. Optical illusion. Where you see like things like there's water on the street, on a tarmac, you see like water. When you get there, there's no water. You see it again, going forward like that. Optical illusion. That's what you think it is. So here, the Lord is reminding us. We fight with the devil. We have got to make a decision because there is joy at the end of it. Like I said, it's contrary to our nature. Lust is hanging off our flesh. Opposition made by the devil and the enmity of the world against religion, against Christianity. All these things, they make the nature of this gate straight. If you are fighting this, all these forces that you are fighting against, the flesh, this devil, all these things have got to remain at that gate, where everything, nothing unholy enters in this. The Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away, and behold, all things become new. Why did the Bible say that? Because as you are entering onto the new gate, once you get into the new gate, all the lusts of the flesh from behind, you leave them. Remember, there are accusations. The devil always comes to accuse. He will always come and accuse. He knows you by name, but he calls you by your sin. They say, that old prostitute. He still calls you by your former profession. Because why? He wants a constant reminder of what it is. Be in sin that God has not accepted you. God is wicked. Your God does not tell you the truth. Your sin has not been taken away. But the Bible teaches us the Lord blots away sins. The Bible says, whosoever hearken unto me shall dwell safely and shall be quiet from fear of evil. That is Proverbs chapter 1, verse 33. Whoso hearken unto me, whoever listens to me shall dwell in safety. So there is an element of obedience. But for you to get to obedience, you must come to repentance. And repentance is to agree with God that you are a sinner and you cannot save yourself. Because the Lord Jesus Christ said, He that overcometh shall inherit all the things, and I'll be his God, and he shall be my son. If you enter, if you overcome. So, brethren, I do not know where that nonsense comes from, where people are being told oneself forever saved. He's saying you must overcome. It's like you're writing an examination, you must get 50 plus 1 for you to be considered as a pass. Depending on what course you are reading for or what you are studying for. So you cannot wake up and just say, things go on like this. You must overcome. There is overcoming to be done. It's not enough that I'm in school. Until you get that positive piece of paper that affirms your credentials. That's why you call it formal education. So you have been tested on your competencies, on certain things that you, on the area of expertise, on the area that you are pursuing. So you must overcome for you to get that acknowledgement. Same thing, if we want to get into the kingdom of God, we must overcome. But we know that God is holy. God is holy in the past, is holy in the present, is holy in the future. So God is always holy. Say, be ye holy, for I am holy. So how do we enter in by this narrow gate, by this gate now? One, we have to come out for ourselves. Be no longer yourself. Say, God, give the right of way to the Holy Spirit. You are coming out of yourself. It's no longer about you. Galatians chapter 2. So coming to Christ in the free promise of the gospel. You are coming in the free. He said, whoever so whosoever cometh unto me, I shall indeed not cast away. So that's the same promise. So we are coming unto God by Christ. That's why I say we come without shame unto the throne of grace. We come without shame because our sins have been paid for. So what does it mean, entering? We discern where the gates are. That means we have got to leave everything behind. We have got to find necessity entering into that narrow gate. That narrow gate is holiness. This is the only condition which was given by God in the Bible to meet him. He said, follow peace with all men and live a holy life. For without God, no one shall see the Lord. Praise the Lord. Please forgive me, I'm not quite well. Yes, of course. Finish through. So, we need to discern the gate. Where is the gate? Is this way. Holiness, like we said, that's where the gate is. You do not get into holiness without repentance. Repentance, like I said, you have got to agree with God. And all the pleasures of the world must remain at that gate for you to enter. Say, now God, I'm ready to start the journey. You help, you being my guide, I'll be able to sail through. Because it's not by might, it's not by power, my spirit. So you must have this joy to forego the present. You know, whatever it is that is happening in the world, I don't need to know about it. I'll be safe. I'll be happy. My Lord God, I will do anything. let me remind us, brethren, if you are walking carelessly, you cannot get a safe arrival. You cannot get there safely. You come in, one leg is here, one leg is here. He said, no, I know God now. I know God. Telling people you know God. God is not your neighbor. God is not your neighbor that you know. Living carelessly, you will die like a fool. Because if you go to sleep that night, the Lord gives you the grace not to come back again, you are born and gone for. There's only one answer the Lord Jesus Christ gives in hell. Only one answer. It's great. Lord, give me one more chance. Let me go and tell them. It is too late. As he says this, he is crying. He is crying. Our choir in Kumba branch, they're saying heaven is for a prepared people. Heaven is for a prepared people. We saw the song that I was playing all along, the complete Holiness Mission song. Very inspiring. They've got about 5, 6 songs that they composed. So seeing that CHMI is a center of excellence and emblem of holiness. Let me be very clear. What say complete? When I designed that logo, the one that we have, that green logo that you see in the background, it is something, there are a lot of things that just came in like, make it like this CHMI. Maybe it was divine inspiration, we do not know. But it covers, you see the green, the white, the circles inside, that means you cannot go out of that circle. It must, you must be holy. We are not going to lower the bar except what, except below the, or to live below the price which the Lord Jesus Christ has given. It must be complete. So if you walk carelessly, if you think you can get out of that circle and be saved, you'll be lying to. Only those who start well will end well. If you start well, if you start bad, you're going to end bad. The broad road. The Bible says there's a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof, the ways of death. It's written in two chapters, Proverbs chapter 14, verse 12, Proverbs chapter 16, verse 25. It's the same Bible verse, but it was repeated twice. I don't know the significance, but there's something about it was, it's an emphasis. So what happens in this white gate? A deceitful way, an unprofitable way. It's a restless way. It's a disappointing way. Everywhere disappointment. It's an easy way to fall on. You go in, it's like you're walking on snow. You fall down. That's how easy it is to fall on. It is easy walking in it, but it is not easy getting off it. That's where the challenge is now. The comfort which it gives you now, it's not easy to come out of the broad road. You don't get easily come, you don't come, it's not easy coming out of it. It's a trifling way, you cannot come out of it. You say, if I come out of it, this one doesn't look very comfortable. It looks comfortable, but you are paying the price already. You have mortgaged your eternity. You have mortgaged your eternity. So this way leads to destruction. Because why? This is what God always reminds us. There is a way which is right unto a man, but at the end of the way is death. This is the constant voice of the word of God. The justice of God is demanded. The nature of things also accepts it, that it must be so. And the voice of the natural conscience confirms it. The Holy Spirit says, your conscience is, if your conscience is spirit, if your conscience condemns you, it means you're condemned. So we need to be aware of these things, that you are condemned. Why are the multitude in the Broadway? Because this is the universal corruption of human nature. That's why the people are always called on the multitude. The child of God has been sent to the world. The broad road is the most agreeable way to our corrupt nature. Easy, because we are blind, our minds is blinded, the eyes of our heart are blinded. We cannot see. Like I said, the broad way is the easiest, therefore is also on that way. He says, come my friend, therefore calls you friend when you're walking on the same path. So you need to be very careful. Salvation, it's not easy. But he said, for by grace you are saved through faith, not of ourselves. It is the gift of God, salvation. So what is the difficulty, the difficulty of obtaining this excellency? Because Christ, see what Christ paid for us. He had to go onto the cross. What it cost God's Spirit to bring men sad to it. What it cost ministers of God to persuade people. What it cost Christians, after all, to obtain it. And what does it cost half Christians who goes without it? The half Christians, the pseudo Christians, people were just coming in on Sunday, said, yeah, Pastor, good morning. These are pseudo Christians, these are half Christians. I'm just trying to be polite not to call them pseudo Christians. None born again in the church today. So, salvation, this is the difficult to enter. To enter is not easy. Because why? The same Bible even says we should beware of this evil man, the false prophet. So we need to be sure that we are receiving the correct word. We are not being told what we want to hear. Whilst we are thinking of the teachers that are outside, let us not forget that we're also inside. Most of there are dangerous ministers of God who are preaching heresies. I heard one servant of God, very respected, with a huge following, said Jesus Christ is not a lion of Judah. People are clapping hands like this. When you increase too much theology, it becomes entertainment. These are people say, I want to tell you where God was when he was creating the world. It has no significant spiritual significance for life. If you know that God was sitting when he was creating the world, of what value is it to your Christian life? All those things is pure entertainment, brethren. Do not sit under such administration. Being entertained. It's good that you hear that. So what? Is the Lord Jesus Christ that they were here after dinner? I said, let us make this. If God can tell you I was doing this, what are you going to do about it? Nothing. So people need to be very careful about the message that is being preached. The Baptists came preaching the same message. Repent, for the kingdom of God is here. The Lord Jesus Christ came preaching the same word. Apostle Peter, Apostle Paul, they also came with the same message. Why have we changed? Why have we changed the scriptures? Now we are telling people God is going to bless you. Not about blessings, but entrance. Isaiah 26, verse 20. Come, my people, enter into thy presence, the door behind you. It's about entering at the end of the day. Narrower is the way now towards, as we go towards the finish now, we can see technology is coming almost on a daily basis. Things that we never thought we could do. There are benefits to technology. We are seeing people, we are ministering to millions of people through social media. That's commendable. But it can also be used negatively. I have known of women who have gotten pregnant over the same social media, being used negatively. You go on Facebook, you are sitting on the headquarters of the head of the devil. All things are happening. Say, but what is happening? What is happening? Yes, that is what is happening. It's open to anything. And everything goes. Those that are looking for to marry, those that are looking for this, there's a lot of deceit. A lot of deceit. Many today are going in there to scam people of their monies. Yeah, we need church. Can I join your group? Yes, these are scammers, hackers. Come in, hack your phone, start asking for money from people using your phone number. So let us remember that narrow is the way, and narrower is the way now than it was before. It's not everybody that you see. People have learned the, it's a learned behavior, Christian vocabulary. They now know, praise the Lord, hallelujah. Praise the Lord, hallelujah. That's what they know. They do it. But when they come and say that, to God be the glory, but you are deceived because you think they are Christian. Not everybody, because not every time where God's name is called, where is into it. At times it's got nothing to do with it. Absolutely nothing to do with it. So today the Lord is calling us onto the narrow path. The path is narrow, there are sacrifices to be made. You need to live a consecrated life. You need to live a life that is given unto Christ. You need to live a life that you give the Holy Spirit the right of way to determine the course of it. That is the narrow path. Where everything, God says, surrender your whole self to me. Give your whole self no rights, no human rights. I'm a child. My mother is saying this, I have got a right, no human rights. As long as you are a Christian, no rights given, full stop. No rights at all. There are no rights for a Christian. Once you find yourself having rights, the devil is at you. They offended me, it's my right. It's my right to do this. It's my right. No, a child of God, they called the Lord Jesus Christ Beelzebub. They called him as possessed by the evil spirit, but he never said anything. He was God walking on him. Even the angel said, the mystery, the Bible said the mystery. Because the angel said, people don't know that God is walking on earth. They said they don't know. The angels were fearing. When they roamed, come to the earth, they say, sir, they say, hey, don't greet me that way. Don't let anybody know. That's why they were surprised. God walked on the earth. We never recognized it. Some even insulted him. But he has paid the price because we should all go through the narrow way. Narrow is the way, straight is the gate that enters into his presence. When I got the revelation last year, it was something very significant. As I struggled through, it was a long journey. When I say long journey, very long journey, bruised and battered. The same way the Lord Jesus Christ appeared on the cross, bruised and battered. That's how you enter spirit. When you see, when he reveals your body like this, you will be bruised and battered. You will see yourself, oh, this was the journey. He said, yes, arrows coming. Yes. The enemy is at work. Everything that is throwing at you is injuring you. So you will see yourself, oh, that's how the Lord was. Yes, that's how you would be. Salvation, the journey of salvation is not a walk on the path. It takes a lot of grace of God to be able to walk on that path. It's a very difficult path, but the Lord God said, I will sustain you. Because why? This is the tenderness of a merciful God. He said, I'll be with you. You are my children. Come to me. Come, I will protect you. Run to the foot of the cross. Once you come to the foot of the cross, he has got a way of solving our challenges. So today, the Lord is calling us, like I said, in rounding up with my revelation, where I was being taken up. It was an arduous journey. So narrow was the path. It was so narrow, like less than 40, 50 centimeters, less than half a meter. It was 30, 40 centimeters like this, as you are going. Any slip up, you are gone. I struggled until when I reached that at the top, that's when the Lord said, he quoted Revelation 21, verse 27. He said, nothing unholy will enter into my presence. Even if you save me 47 years, that was the number of years that I had. Even if you save me 47 years, you know, that's what he said. So the journey is tough, but it encourages us that we can get there by his grace. Because it's not by might, so by power, but by his spirit. So the Lord is calling us unto the narrow path to forgo the pleasures of the lust of sin, the pleasures of our body, anything that becomes an obstacle, take it to the cross daily. Once you go on the narrow path, in the beginning it's painful, but as you learn to live with it, you become joy in the midst of all the challenges. It begins to minister to you. So, brethren, I'm here to encourage us that narrow is the way that leadeth life. And on this path, it's a path of holiness. It's a path of righteousness. That's why he told Father Abraham that walk before me and be thou perfect. Enoch walked with God and he was no more. He said in Exodus chapter 19, verse 5, when he was calling Israel to himself, he wanted Israel to be a nation of priests, holy unto him, holy and consecrated unto the Lord, so that they can become an example to others. Today, God is calling us to be examples unto us. Let us not become obstacles with the way that we live. We know that God's name is blasphemed amongst the Gentiles because of the way that we live. May the Lord help us. May the Lord guide us on this narrow path. I pray that all of us, I wish I would say all of us, we are going to enter. But it takes great determination and character for you to enter. Make up your mind. There is no half Christian. If you are half, he's going to throw it. He said, I'll spew you out of my mouth. I'll spew you out of my mouth. He is going to throw you away. Either you are in or you are out. Either you are hot or you are cold. But the door to life is open. I'll round up with this scripture. Behold, I call upon heaven and earth today to witness this against. God is saying, come, this is the narrow way that leads to life for me and my children, for you and your children, for you and your family and siblings. He said, this day is going to stand as a witness to this ministration. That he is saying, come, so that you and your offspring, you and your siblings can be saved. He's not asking for you. Come the way you are. Get what the devil calls you. The devil didn't create you. He created you. Father, I humble myself in your presence. I come, as sinful as I am. Make me whole. Blot all my sins. I want to start a new life. I want to start all over again. If I've been deceived by the devil, Lord, if I have deceived myself to believe I've made it, Lord, have mercy upon me. Give me the grace of repentance. Then you begin to work on your journey. I give you, woman of God. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.